Good evening. My name is Sloan Shoemaker. I'm the director of the Wilderness Workshop. This microphone does not help you hear me better, but it helps people out in TV land hear me better. So that's why I have it. Thanks to Grassroots for videoing us tonight, and they're going to broadcast it for us as well. I want to make sure we acknowledge our sponsors. There's a series of slides rotating through here that has our sponsors on it that make this program possible for us and allow us to have Grassroots to video for us. So thank you, our sponsors. Tonight's presentation is part of the Naturalist Night series, which is co-hosted by the Wilderness Workshop, the Aspen Center for Environmental Studies, where we are now, obviously, and the Roaring Fork Audubon. I'll point your attention to the Wilderness Workshop's display over here, and there's some more stuff from the Audubon group down next to Eric. Let's see. Okay, I'm making sure I covered all my bases there. We're really pleased to have Eric Odell here tonight. Eric is the director of the Species Conservation Program. Did I get that right? Close enough? At Colorado Parks and Wildlife. And I've known Eric for a long time. In fact, Eric worked for the Wilderness Workshop back in 1998 when I was a single solo staff person and he was a young undergrad, and we've both come a little way since then. It's good. But Eric has become quite the expert on not only the ecology and natural history of the Wolverine, but an important element for what he's doing is the socio-political element of it. You can't do species conservation without engaging in the social and political context of that. And many people that go into the field of natural resources management do it because they like to be out in the woods and deal with animals. And really, the animal they need to be dealing with is us. That's the biggest management problem. And so Eric's gotten a crash course of that in that as he's been ramping up this Wolverine program. So without much further ado, I'd like to welcome Eric Odell from Colorado Parks and Wildlife.
Thanks, Sloan, and thanks everybody for coming, and thanks for having me here, and thanks to the sponsors and facilitators as well. It is really fun to be here. I did my graduate work here in the Roaring Fork Valley in 15 years ago when Sloan and I were both teenagers, and so it's good to come back and see the same spots. Let me just switch things here a little bit. Oops. Here, you can see that again. There we go. Okay, so as Sloan said, I'm Eric Odell, and I'm from Colorado Parks and Wildlife, which is formerly known, you may have also known of us as the Colorado Division of Wildlife. We've recently merged with state parks, and so now this new agency, we're the state wildlife agency that's responsible for managing all the species in the state, not only the deer and the elk, but also the game and the non-game species as well. And so that's here to talk to you specifically today about the Wolverine. And just out of curiosity, for my own interest, I know that a couple weeks ago, or maybe a couple months ago, Tanya Shank came and spoke about the lynx reintroduction program. How many saw that? How many were part of that? Good, quite a few of you. So what I'm going to talk about today is really the front end of that. We're interested in the idea of a Wolverine reintroduction, but no decisions have been made. We haven't decided as to whether we will or we won't go forward with this. We're in this process, as Sloan explained, of really figuring out the social and political sides of wildlife management, and specifically the non-game recovery sides of things, too. So hopefully in 10 years I can come back and give the same kind of talk that Tanya gave about lynx, and I can talk about Wolverine, but again, we're not quite there yet. So those of you that had the opportunity to see the animal, the specimen that's out in the lobby, that's a really unique opportunity. That's pretty neat to be able to see that. But I wanted to show a picture of what wolverines really are. They're in the weasel family. So they have this terrible, ferocious reputation of being this very villainous kind of animal, and even characterized in the X-Men superhero kinds of things. And so they're really quite different, and they're really not as well known, and the more that we study them, the more that we learn about them, those kinds of reputations are maybe being dismissed a little bit. So they're they're about 35, 40 pounds. They're built for living in the alpine environment. These are incredibly wild animals. They resemble a small bear, except they have a long, bushy tail. This photo doesn't really do that. You can see that on the specimen. You'll see it on some of the other photos that I'll show today, too. They have built-in snowshoes. Their feet are, they walk what's called plantigrade, so the whole foot walks on the snow. It gives them much better flotation. They have these built-in claws, these crampons, that allow them to climb incredible ice features and snow features in the middle of winter. They have this home range. The males cover a home range, which is really the territory that they cover, of 600 square miles. And they'll cover that area in a 3 or 4 week period. So these animals are moving incredible distances. They move 20 to 30 miles in a day in a high alpine environment in the middle of winter. The females have a smaller home range. They're probably about 200 square miles, but it's still an incredible, for the size of these animals, 10-inch legs, what they can cover and what they can do is pretty incredible. There have been a few media stories about them. PBS put out a great documentary called Chasing the Phantom. If you haven't seen that, it's a great information. And Doug Chadwick is an author who's done a lot of really great writing, and he put out a book called The Wolverine Way. I highly recommend both of those. And in Doug's book, he talks about his book is about his experience in volunteering for the Glacier National Park Wolverine Project, and he talks about, you know, he says there's wild and then there's Wolverine. They're just a level above wild. These are really incredible creatures. What's really key to understand partly about their ecology, and first thing I should say is that all of the photographs in here, except for one, are not from animals in Colorado, and you'll see that in a second. But you know, thankfully we've got photographers that have donated or given us ability to use our photographs in this presentation, so thanks to them very much. The really important point about wolverines is their reliance on springtime snow, and that comes for their reproduction. The females dig their dens in the early winter, early spring, February timeframe, and they dig deep down into the snow, and that's where they have their kits, and they keep their kits there. Kits are born about a month ago, but middle of February, February 14th is what people like to think of Valentine's Day, is when the kits are born. And they'll keep them in that den, and they may move them around from den to den, but they really are reliant on that springtime snow. You'll see why that's an important thing to know about these animals as I get further into this. So a little history in where we've been and what we've thought about for wolverine and lynx as well. So in the mid to late 90s, the Colorado Division of Wildlife at the time, with a bunch of other agencies, put together this draft plan for how are we were interested in the reestablishment of both lynx and wolverine into the Southern Rockies, which of course is Colorado, Wyoming, New Mexico. And at the time, in the late 90s, we began the lynx reintroduction. The first reintroduction was in 1999, and that went through 2006, and Tanya talked about that. And it became a success. We have documented multiple generations of reproduction of lynx in the wild, so we've documented that reproduction is greater than mortality. So we've got a self-sustaining population of lynx in Colorado. And so that when we got to that point, we determined that in late 2009, early 2010. And then we started to switch gears a little bit, started to re-engage with the wolverine idea anyways. So where do wolverines live? This is where they live. They have this high alpine environment. They cover, as I said earlier, this huge home range. They live circumpolar, meaning that they're in the northern hemisphere, in Asia, Russia, all the way into Canada, Alaska, the whole North America. They live in this Arctic, subarctic, alpine environment. In Alaska, they'll come down all the way to the coastline. They'll be coastal animals. But they generally, for what we think of as wolverine habitat in Colorado, it's this high alpine, snow, tree-lined kind of habitat. It's a very unproductive habitat, and that's part of the reason why they are so low density. I mean, these animals cover such huge home ranges and I should also emphasize, the home ranges don't overlap. The male home range of 600 square miles may overlap two or three female home ranges, but the male home ranges generally do not overlap. So they're very widely dispersed, and so they have very unproductive habitats. They eat just about anything. They'll eat freshly killed stuff. They'll eat stuff that they kill. They'll eat stuff that's long dead. They'll eat bones of animals there's really nothing left. These animals survive really on the brink of starvation in a lot of ways, and so they're truly just wild, wild animals. And of course, these areas have a very short growing season. So they, or these areas have a short growing season. They don't have a whole lot of areas to rely on vegetation growth or anything like that. They will eat vegetation as well. And of course, the snow persisting into the summer months is key for that denning aspect. So this figure depicts their home range or their distribution throughout the world, really. And there's two different subspecies. The subspecies in Asia, in the Russia is gulo gulo gulo, gluttonous glutton glutton, I suppose. And in Colorado or in the not Colorado in the North America, it's gulo gulo luscious. So there's two different distinct subspecies, and there's some genetic variation within the North American population. But just to give you a feeling of where they are, let's see if my cursor comes up here. It does. So here we are in Colorado, the southern Rockies. So that historically, and you'll see this in the next slide, but they did come all the way down, following the Rocky Mountains down into the lower 48. The next few slides are some pictures of their historical distribution. So these, in the top right, you'll see that it's 1827 to 1960. If the time frame had really been to the early 1900s, maybe 1920, this may be a little bit more informative. But the last time that we knew of a wolverine in Colorado was 1919, prior to more recently. So they were widely distributed throughout North America. And the real cause of their decline was the trapping of predator control efforts. And the wolverine, not that they were specifically targeted, but they have this huge range. They have this real innate ability to scent out carcasses or other kinds of things which were used as poison bait. And so they were victim, probably unintentional, but they really were wiped out in the lower 48 in the early 1900s through that effort. And so then more recently, in the late early 60s through the early 1990s, they recolonized. And most of this, where's the cursor here? Well, in Montana, Idaho, Wyoming, that recolonization is from the populations in Canada and Alberta, in British Columbia and Alberta, that's naturally recolonized with all the logging and timber and recreation and those kinds of things that were happening then. And there's been a little bit more decline in the more recently, in the 1995 to 2005 timeframe. And so you can see that it's been a while. Historically, they did cover this area, but they're not anywhere near here right now. This gives you a feeling for how many animals there are in the lower 48. So in Alaska, there's thousands. There's a trapping season. They are sport trapped there. Their pelt is very desirable. In British Columbia, Alberta, there's thousands estimated of animals. When you start talking about the lower 48, it's a totally different picture. You know, we have maybe 250, 300 animals in all of the lower 48. Montana is by far the stronghold for the species. And up until this year, they too had a trapping season that's been stopped. But there's also a population, viable population in Idaho and some animals in Wyoming, more in the Yellowstone ecosystem. You see one animal in Colorado, one animal that I should take that question mark off of California. It's been documented, there is an individual, and those are males that have made that move down. I'll talk a bit more about the Colorado animal in a second. But so we're talking about a very small number of animals. Colorado has maybe the potential, if a reintroduction were to take place, maybe there would be 100 animals in Colorado total at maximum capacity. So it's not that many animals, but it's an opportunity to increase the lower 48 population by maybe a third. So what have they been in Colorado? And this is the photo of the one animal that is in Colorado. His moniker is M56, and I'll give you a bit of a story, more detail about him in a little bit. So they are a native species to Colorado. It's not as though we're trying to do an introduction, it's a reintroduction. So we're trying to get this population reestablished in the state, or the idea is to get the population reestablished. And there's not currently a viable population. We know of this one animal, and again, I'll talk about him in a second, but with the pre-work that we did with the lynx, we've done extensive surveys, both for wolverine and lynx. They get linked, poor choice of word perhaps, but the wolverine and the lynx get linked up in philosophy or in thought quite a bit, but they're really quite different animals. The lynx are very much a habitat-specific species. They really rely on that spruce fir forest. They're very much a prey-dependent species. The snowshoe hare and the red squirrel are really key for lynx survival. Wolverine, on the other hand, are habitat generalists and prey generalists. So they're very different. They get viewed as being occupying the same area, but they're very different. So that's one of the things that I try to emphasize, and any time I get the opportunity to talk to groups, is, you know, they have this reputation and this thought of being the same, but they're really quite different. So our Wildlife Commission, we have a state endangered species act. Wolverine were declared an endangered species in the state, and when that act was passed in 1973. And again, there have been numerous survey efforts from over the last 30 years looking to see if there were any Wolverine sightings or Wolverine populations existing in the state. And all of the efforts came up with no confirmed sightings. And in fact, there are very few confirmed sightings in Colorado, even prior to the 1919. So this is the story of M56. This is pretty interesting. The Wildlife Conservation Society is another one of our partners, and they've got a biologist that's done quite a bit of work up in the Yellowstone system. So he collared M56 in May of 2009 near Grand Teton National Park at Tawagatte Pass. And they put a collar on him, and they also put an abdominal implant. So they literally sutured, did surgery, put a couple batteries into his abdominal cavity, and that emits a signal that we can track from the airplanes. So this animal left. As soon as he was collared, he left in May of 2009, and the green in this map and in subsequent maps is modeled Wolverine habitat. And that it's a complex model, but it really is modeled after the springtime snowpack, persistent springtime snow. So what's interesting to look at this is, so he made it through, went through the southern mountains in, let's see if my pointer comes up, here it is, the southern mountains in Wyoming, and then crosses the Red Desert in pretty much a straight line fashion, and then finds this Wolverine habitat, this high alpine environment in the snowy range, and then makes his way down, was photographed in Rocky Mountain National Park in June of 2009. That was the photograph that you just saw. It was by a photographer that just happened to be in the right place at the right time. And we knew that he was there. We knew that the animal had come because as soon as he started to make these moves, the Wildlife Conservation Society, the WCS guys, told us about it. And so we were monitoring him from our airplane. So the collar that he had was a GPS collar. So it was storing all this very precise information where he was. When he was photographed, he didn't have that collar on. So that abdominal implant became key because that's how we track him now. As far as we know, he's still here. Now, we're not doing a lot of dedicated flights for him just because of the resources that are involved. We can have him one day in one location, and if we're not following him on a daily basis in a week, he could literally be 100 miles away. And so we just don't have the resources to follow him. When our pilots are up doing work for other species, they do scan the frequencies and try to keep tabs of them, but we're not always all that successful doing it. The last time we had a point in was in October near Winter Park.
Are those dots equal time reports? So like, you tell how long?
Right. They're not, no. So these are telemetry points that when they were in the airplane. So they were up in the airplane capturing him. So the data from the GPS collar were never recovered. The collar's not been found. So no, this is in more opportunistic points. Good question. Okay, so this map shows the Wolverine habitat in the lower 48. The green is the same Wolverine habitat, modeled Wolverine habitat. Now you're looking more at the whole lower 48. You can see that dark blue area that says zone 1. Hopefully you can read that. That's their current distribution. That's where they are in Montana, Idaho, Wyoming. That light blue band is kind of an uncertain. Sometimes, you know, because they are wide-ranging animals, you don't really know exactly where they are all the time. They do get reports in the bighorns from time to time, whether they're confirmed or they've not been confirmed. They do get reports down in southern Wyoming, but again, they're in the Wind Rivers, and so that there was an animal that was actually sighted down there. So that it's a fuzzy line. There's not a distinct boundary there. But then that green area is areas of historical occupation, but not currently occupied. So as I said earlier, the males have these large dispersal rates, but the females have extremely low dispersal rates. The young females tend to take over the maternal home ranges, and so they don't have that same instinctual long dispersals the way males do, where they will go on these quite long movements like M56 did, like the animal in California did, presumably. And so the point of this is that really to get a population reestablished in the southern Rockies, if that's desired, is for an active reintroduction. It's not going to happen in the kind of time frame that we think about within our lifetimes to have multiple animals, especially females, make that long distance movement down into this habitat. And so what does the habitat look like in Colorado? So the primary factor that we're using to model our wolverine habitat is that snow cover layer. When you start to look at the ownership of the habitat, it's largely public lands. So of that, the modeled habitat is about 8.2 million acres of land in Colorado is suitable wolverine habitat. And the vast majority of that, 7.2 million acres, is Forest Service owned. And of that, probably about half of that is either BLM or Forest Service wilderness areas or Park Service lands. So that's an important point that I'll come back to in a little bit, that high reliance on that public land habitat. And I said earlier that they're not a prey-specific species, and so I don't want this to get misinterpreted, but the marmots can't, in the springtime, especially as the marmots come out of hibernation, wolverine do not hibernate. As the marmots come out of hibernation, they're a great food source for the females and the kits. And so the red is the modeled marmot habitat. We don't have a really clean map of where marmots are distributed in the state, but that we do know that they're pretty widely distributed, and so there's marmots are just one example of a potentially good prey item for wolverine. So that's kind of the natural history side of things. Now I'm gonna shift gears a little bit. I'm gonna start talking about the social and the political and that side of where the wolverine story has been. And so it really goes back to the early 90s when some of the environmental groups, the conservation groups, petitioned the Fish and Wildlife Service, the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, who's the federal agency mandated with it, implementing the Endangered Species Act, separate from Colorado Parks and Wildlife. So I want to make that distinction. The Federal Fish and Wildlife Service was petitioned for listing in 1994, and in a variety of different times, 1995, 2003, and 2008, they found that the petitions weren't substantial or there was not warranted for listing, meaning that the species did not need listing did not need protection under the Endangered Species Act. In 2009, they began another status review, and that's right about the time that we began our process, the Colorado Parks and Wildlife began our process, and so keep that kind of time frame in mind. I'll come back to that. In 2010, from that status review, the Fish and Wildlife Service determined that the species was warranted but precluded, essentially putting it on this candidate list, which doesn't give it Endangered Species Act protection, but it also indicates that there's something that could be done or something that needs to be done for this species. And very recently, in February of 2013, Fish and Wildlife Service published a proposed rule to list the species as threatened and also to establish a 10J, an experimental non-essential area. And I'll talk about that in detail in a little bit. In the Fish and Wildlife Service analysis, they go through a very detailed threats analysis as part of their consideration of the petitions. The primary threat to this species is climate change, and it really deals with that heavy reliance on the springtime snows. So as the climate warms, the springtime snow recedes uphill and also just diminishes in general. And so the Fish and Wildlife Service assessment is that without that threat, without the threat of climate change, the species would not be warranted for listing. And that's a really interesting aspect. And it's the same situation with polar bears, and I think maybe with American walrus too, although I'm not totally sure on that. Several other activities that they consider in their threats analysis, for those of you that are familiar with Endangered Species Act, they go through a whole five factor analysis, were viewed to be potentially a threat when you consider the effects of climate change, but in and of themselves, they were not a threat. So it's really just that climate change issue that's the threat to the species. So of those secondary threats, they consider many of these other kinds of things that you think about: infrastructure development, transportation corridors, dispersed recreation, lack of regulatory mechanisms, and that's a little bit technical term, but what are the federal agencies' abilities to manage this? Incidental trapping and then small population size. So in their analysis, the four top bullets were found to not be a threat at all, and it's only these bottom two bullets that are threats in concert with the climate change issue. So this incidental trapping really doesn't pertain so much to Colorado. We have pretty strict trapping regulations. It's more in the northern Rockies specifically with the wolf trapping that's going on up there. And then the small population size. Anytime you have animals that are, you're talking about 200 or 300 animals in a big area like this, you get concerned about genetic issues and inbreeding and just accidental losses to individuals. And so why our arguments is that this is how we're thinking about it. Why should we consider it? Why is this even something that should be considered? Well, Colorado is native to the, this species is native to Colorado. It's a big area of unoccupied, formerly historic range of the species, and it's of good quality too. Getting a population established in the Southern Rockies would improve the resiliency of the species range-wide. And in the Fish and Wildlife Service's public notices or proposed rules, they've said that the most beneficial conservation action for the species is to get a population reestablished in the Southern Rockies. And this is an important point too. The high country that we have in Colorado, even though it is the most southerly latitude point in the distribution, it's also the highest elevation. And that's a really important point. When these climate models show that the snow line is going to recede, the amount of springtime snow is going to decrease, but because of that high elevation, it's going to decrease at a lower rate. The models show that it's going to decrease at a lower rate in Colorado. So it's not to say that Colorado won't be affected by climate change, but it will be affected at a different rate. And so potentially the low elevation, the relatively low elevation wolverine habitat in Montana, Idaho, Wyoming may be entirely gone or gone to a point where it's of limited value. Colorado will hopefully, we hope, retain quite a bit of good wolverine habitat, good snow, springtime snow. And so this 10J area, this slide maybe make a little bit more sense in after a few more discussions. But this is the map. The 10J area is a line on the map. And within that area, it's saying, oh, this is an area where there were currently animals, but there aren't anymore. And so it allows a way to provide a lot of assurances to stakeholders as to how their needs can be met. And you'll understand that in just a second. Within that area, there's no consultation. There's no Section 7 consultation for Forest Service actions within that area, and there's no need for forest management plan revisions. And so that takes into consideration some of the social sides of things. It also takes into consideration the biological sides of things. Because these animals are so wide-ranging, because they have such a wild nature to them and they cover such a big area, it's biologically defensible that they don't need protections from a particular timber sale or ski area development or something like that, which you know, causes a little bit of concern from time to time in some people, but really you'll see why it was really important for us to get that 10J status. So where have we been with Colorado Parks and Wildlife? So in I believe it was June of 2009, I asked our commission, our wildlife commission at the time, if we could begin the conversation with stakeholders. We did not ask them for permission to do the reintroduction. We've not asked for or received that permission yet. We really just wanted to begin this process, begin these conversations. And so what we did is convene a stakeholder group. And with that, it was all these different groups that you think might be affected, potentially affected, by some kind of action such as putting a threatened or an endangered species on the landscape that rely on federal lands for some part of their efforts. So it's the ski groups, the timber groups, mining, agricultural, off-highway vehicles, recreation industries, this off-highway vehicle groups, I think I said, and as well as the conservation community. And so everybody's represented at the table, and really our effort was to determine what are the concerns. And our director at the time said that we're not going to proceed with this. We're not going to do a reintroduction of wolverines unless we can address these important points, these social, political, and economic concerns. And so with that framework in mind, essentially we're saying, you know, we have the opportunity to do something good, but we're not going to do it if it's going to be at a huge expense to all of these. Expense in a figurative way, not necessarily a financial expense, but in a time and effort expense. And so if you think back to that timeline, when we began our conversations, wolverines were proposed for listing, which is kind of this very nebulous kind of status. They don't have any federal protection. The Fish and Wildlife Service wasn't really clear on where they were. Then they made this warranted but precluded determination that it was put it on this candidate list in December of 2010. And so then you have the species that's supposed to be listed. There are determined threats to this species, but it's this candidate status. And on federal lands, it's really difficult to provide the kinds of assurances for a candidate species. We can talk more about that if you're interested. But the point of it is that the stakeholders' concerns were very difficult to address with this candidate status. And by far, with the conservation community aside, the all the industry groups, their concern wasn't necessarily the presence of Wolverine on the landscape. We're not talking about wolves on the landscape that have very immediate and very direct threats to a lot of livestock interests. Their concern was being limited in their abilities to pursue their interests, whether it's skiery operations or timber management or those kinds of things. And so because we couldn't provide any kind of assurances, or the Fish and Wildlife Service, I should say, couldn't provide those assurances to the stakeholders, it was really troublesome. We were really struggling to kind of find some kind of a solution to this. And then there was this thing called the MDL settlement, this multi-district litigation settlement, which in a nutshell was these groups, these conservation groups that petitioned the Fish and Wildlife Service to list species, came to an agreement with Fish and Wildlife and said, okay, time out, we're not going to petition any more of these species. Fish and Wildlife Service, you guys can dedicate your resources to addressing that candidate list. And Wolverine were included on that. And so that created this kind of break in the process. So we said, well, because things are uncertain as to, we know something's going to happen with this. We put the stakeholder process on hold at that point, waiting to see what was going to come up with Fish and Wildlife Service. Now that just last month they came out with their proposed rules, we're interested in reinitiating the stakeholder group. So the proposed rules were published in February of 2013. And so now if we're to go forward, and if is a big bolded underlined statement, and the important point, no decisions have been made. We haven't asked for permission, and we haven't gotten permission because we haven't asked for it. And there's two important decision-making groups that are involved in this, and you'll see why it's so important for us to do this stakeholder process. Because it's a federally listed species, we have to have not only Parks and Wildlife, our commission, which is our governor-appointed board that directs our agency, but we also have to have state legislative approval to do this. And what that means is that a specific bill has to be passed through the state legislature that says that any Colorado Parks and Wildlife or any state or municipal agency can engage in reintroduction of a threatened species to the state. And so there's a very important political component to this whole process. And so now that we have a fairly certain landscape, we know where things are, we're going to begin, reinitiate the stakeholder meetings in a couple of months or a couple of weeks and see where we go. The Fish and Wildlife Service has an open comment period on their proposed rules that ends May 6th. We'll certainly contribute a letter towards that. And after that, they'll come out with a final rule presumably about 12 months after the proposed rule was published, so potentially February of 2014. And importantly, that 10J area, it has a strong potential to address the stakeholders' concerns. It really provides a lot of the assurances. It lets all of these interests that all these industries that have an interest in federal land management, assurances that their interests aren't going to be compromised because of an effort to do this if we're to go forward. So the beginning of the title of the talk is Can Colorado Play a Role in Contributing to the Conservation of Wolverine in the Face of Climate Change? And so from a biological perspective, it seems that we can. From the social and political perspectives, we're not there yet. It seems like there's potential for that to be there, but we're still working through that and really stay tuned, I guess, is the answer with that. And so with that, I'm done, and I'm happy to take questions. Yeah. So I've been asked to repeat the questions too for the TV. So the question about the number of wolverines, and I said about 100 animals, and that's total. And so 100, our population would be 100 animals, probably on a 50-50 or less, or biased more towards females.
And that's, is that a number of, like, in 2013 you support that with development and the climate we have now? Is that in 1900?
So, and so the question is about time frame. When at one point is that? It's kind of back of it's a rough number. It's a back of the envelope calculation saying we have about 8.2 million acres of modeled habitat now, and their home ranges are so big, and so you divide it all out, and so it's about that. So it's more of a current kind of an estimate. Yeah.
How many animals are they trapping in Alaska every year?
So the question is, how many are they trapping in Alaska? I don't know. I know that in Montana it was a season of the take with quota was 5. So small, entirely small number. I don't know what the number is in Canada or Alaska. In the back.
I have two questions. One with the trapping, if they're listed as warned but included, does that have any effect on trapping right now?
So the question is, does the status of warranted but precluded have any impact on trapping? And the two parts of that question, for warranted but precluded, no. And they don't have federal protections yet because of this proposed rule status. Once a final rule is published, then they'll become a federally listed species. And at that point, the trapping season in the lower 48 would end. And so that's an important point that I should make, is that when they're talking about listing the wolverine, they're talking about a distinct population segment of the lower 48. So they're not talking about listing wolverine in Canada, or in clearly not in Canada, but not in Alaska either. And so that would end the trapping season in Montana.
The other question I had is, when you're showing a picture of potential wolverine habitat for Colorado, it seemed like there was several distinct kind of islands in there. And I know M56, I remember, definitely crossed from a pretty large span from potential habitat areas. Is that typical of wolverines? Is there any concern that they'll develop island populations in Colorado and there,
okay, so that's to for the TV audience. So you talk about just continuity of habitat within Colorado, within the Southern Rockies, and so M56 did clearly cross the Red Desert of Southern Wyoming, and that's not wolverine habitat. There is dispersal, and you know, it's not contiguous habitat in Colorado. Clearly, I-70s are there are transportation corridors that cause breaks. There are. Were you trying to tell me something?
No.
Okay. There's geographic barriers that cause breaks in that continuity of that habitat. And so, from a genetic perspective, that's part of the consideration as to if we were to go forward with the program, where would animals come from? And the idea of genetic bottleneck really comes in from the source populations. How would we address that? And we've made some preliminary discussions on that, but no decisions on that at all. So, really, I think that Colorado would be dispersal throughout the state for sure. I mean, M56. One of the interesting things about M56 is that he's where we found him. We've been looking in wolverine habitat, but he's, you know, the vast majority of those points are within that modeled habitat. So they certainly tend to state that, you know, they prefer that habitat for sure. Did I get your question? Okay. Yeah.
So you said that you had kind of discussed where they were going to be coming from.
Yeah.
Yeah,
so they would not come from the lower 48 because of the DPS population. So they would, you know, we'd take them from Canada or Alaska is really the source. And we haven't gotten any more specific than that. It, you know, there are a lot of different kinds of things that you think about when you think of a reintroduction. Do you want animals that are as genetically diverse? Do you want to bring as genetically diverse of a population down? Or do you want to bring a population that's not naive to the same kind, that's familiar with the same kinds of habitat anyway? So would you consider a coastal population of Alaskan wolverines, or would you prefer Northern Rockies or British Columbian Rocky Mountain wolverine population? So there's all of those different kinds of considerations. Generally, the thought is that you want a broad spectrum, but so you don't want to take them from just one area, but you want to kind of cover all of your bases with that.
If wolverines have been missing from the ecosystem for 100 years, what are some of the things that maybe you're worried about or thinking about in terms of how they might affect the ecosystem after 100 years?
Yeah, so the question is, what is the ecosystem effect, or the cascading effects of putting wolverines on the ground? And so the really common example that you hear about that is with wolves and the effect of wolves on ungulates and herbivory and that kind of stuff. So with wolverine, we're talking about 100 animals throughout the Southern Rockies. So it's really in a very small effect. And so there's really, they are a predator. They are kind of at the top of the food chain kind of an animal, but they don't have a huge ecological impact on a broad scale. And so we really don't expect major changes in that respect. In the back. Yeah, the big concern, so what are the social and political considerations with reintroduction? And what we heard from our stakeholder process was this concern about losing their ability to pursue their interests. So the ski areas are concerned about the ability to operate and manage their ski areas. The timber industry is concerned about their ability to participate in timber logging efforts and those kinds of things. Mining industry wants to be sure that their interests aren't going to be impacted. And really, from a biological perspective, those things happen on such a small scale. Maybe to you and me, it's a big scale, but to a wolverine's view of the landscape. It's such a small scale. And so that their concerns are not so much, as I said, not so much the impacts of wolverines themselves, but the land management implications, the regulation side of things. Yep. Yep. So the question is, if you're talking to somebody that maybe doesn't have the motivation or the idea of restoring animals, wild animals to native range is not in their interest. And we've done that. I mean, that's what the stakeholder process has been. The ski industry, not to isolate them, they've actually been very good partners in a lot of this work, and it's been an interesting process to work with them. But you know, all of these groups don't have their interest is in developing timber, mining, agricultural, you know, the Cattlemen's Association, wool growers, all their interest isn't in getting wolverine on the ground. And so the way you approach it is in a very honest way. You know, you say that this is what we're thinking about, this is why we're interested in it. You explain the process as to why it's important to us and why, as a state wildlife agency, why we're mandated to think about these things and do these things. And as our director said, you know, we're not going to do this at any expense. We're not going to do this at social or political expense. We don't have to do it. It's something that we're certainly interested in, and if we can approach and address the concerns that they bring up, all the better.
So, but getting away from the assumption that most people in this room are passionate about diversity of wildlife and preserving native species, getting away from that, are there any reasons aside from that appreciation for wildlife and for native species bring the wolverine back?
It's a good question, and it's always a challenge of conservation issues. What, you know, why do you do this? Why is this something that we're interested in? And like you say, this is an easy audience to talk to, and there are interested people in doing this. You know, you get the criticism of why do it at all? Why take on this expense? Why take on this responsibility? And the argument back to that is it's what we do and it's what our job is to do, and you're not going to convince people that don't want to be convinced that this is that have that in mind. It's just a matter of having those honest conversations. Yeah.
Now, I know there was so much controversy with the wolves, you know, and from the public, and I know that there are. I mean, a lot of people don't really know too much about wolverines, if they even know what they are, other than an X-Men mm-hmm. character. Do you see any problems with the public? You know, maybe people saying, you know, they're ferocious animals, we don't want them around our, you know, anywhere where our kids might be, or, you know, our dogs, or, you know, whatever. Do you see any of those problems?
Right. So questions about public perception of wolverine, and how do you break that mold? And so... Yeah, I mean it's an interesting thing. And I mean, the X-Men character. And so somebody told me the other day that who's the actor that was the X-Men?
Yeah.
Hugh Jackman. He spent more time studying wolves and wolf behavior in to come up with his character in that whole thing. So yeah, there's this total misperception or there's this total perception anyway, as whether it's incorrectly directed or not, that wolverine are this ferocious, crazy animal that will do anything. And so yeah. Doing talks like this, doing his media outlets, getting the word out that what we're talking about is wolverine and not wolves. We're not talking about wolves at all. It's very important to get that out. And you know, once people see the pictures of them and understand biologically what they are and how they're different, it's a good way to communicate that. Showing the photos and having the opportunity to see the specimen out in the lobby is a great way to get that message across. You had a question.
What's the lifespan?
The lifespan of a wolverine is approximately 15 to 18 years in the wild. Yeah.
What is the likelihood of, say, a pickup truck full of his garage in Colorado that they're actually going to tape and set a shop?
I think I understood the question. What's the likelihood of if 10 animals are released, what's the likelihood of them establishing? And so with any reintroduction, there's a lot to learn. And we have the experience of lynx, and we know with our first efforts to reintroduce lynx, the first several animals that were released didn't do well at all because we didn't know how to deal with it. Nobody's ever moved, relocated, done a reintroduction of Wolverine in the wild. And so this would be the first time anywhere that this is done. And so there's you know, success isn't guaranteed by any means. And that's an important thing to communicate as well, is that doing this absolutely with the best of intentions, but it's not, it's new ground. Nobody's done this before. You don't expect that, clearly you don't expect that if you put 10 animals on the ground, 5 years later, all 10 will be there, or even 15 will be there because of reproduction. The reproductive biology of the species is very sensitive, and just getting reproduction is very difficult. You know, females will become impregnated generally every after 3 years old and on an annual basis, but they don't necessarily always have kits, and that's largely from a resource perspective. And so, there's certainly the likelihood that we hope for success, but there's always the likelihood of failure as well. Somebody had a question in the front.
Good question. So when M58 left the Tetons and went down through the Wind Rivers, I'm just having a hard time imagining why an animal would like cross a large expanse of desert. I mean, is that just this urge to roam that's inherent in the animal, or I mean, you couldn't have depleted all the food sources in the mountains. Mm-hmm. So why leave your habitat and go across incredibly desolate areas?
Yeah. So the question is, why did M56? Why did M56 make the movement that he did? And we don't know. I mean, you can assume maybe it's being pushed out into finding new territories, or maybe it's just this exploratory nature of this animal. We just don't know.
Romance?
He's on his own, as far as we know.
He got jilted,
maybe so, in the back. So what's the cost for doing something like this? We don't know, and we haven't penciled it out. We're careful not to get too far ahead of the game. We want to go through these processes of getting the decisions made by our commission in the legislature. Our Lynx program was over a 10-year period. I don't know exactly the numbers, but this would be less than that for a couple of reasons. One, because we're talking about fewer animals. We wouldn't, for the Lynx program, we moved 218 animals over an 8-year period. Clearly, we're not talking about moving 218 animals to get 100 animal established. If we were to move animals, maybe it would be 30 to 40 animals. And so so that's an inherent decrease in the cost of it. And then also as to whether we'd be able to do as extensive of a monitoring effort as we did with Lynx, where we're going and collaring third and fourth generation kits is a huge challenge with Wolverine just because of their ecology. Yes?
You talked about predators just eating just about anything. Are they a predator on any particular animals, and also are there predators on them?
So are they a predator on a particular animal, or are there predators on them? They're not prey specialists in any manner, meaning that they don't have to have snowshoe hares the way lynx have to have snowshoe hares. They will take whatever is available to them, and sometimes that means depredating on neonate on young deer and elk and those kinds of things. So they will be predators in and of themselves. They'll also be scavengers from avalanche killed or just hunter loss or whatever kinds of animals in the wild. So they don't have a prey specificity at all. Your second part of the question. Right. Yeah. So does anything prey on them? Not really. And there's cases where they've been shown they've scared off grizzly bears off of carcasses or wolves off of carcasses in the northern part of their range. And so, if they'll do that, they're pretty self-sustaining. They're pretty good at defending their sons.
So they have a 600-mile range, the males.
Yeah.
Is that their territory? Are they just each male establishing their own 600 miles?
Yes. So yes.
So
the question is about home ranges, and the males will cover a 600 square mile area, and that's an area that they'll cover in a 3 or 4 week period. They'll cover that area.
Just there, so they'll keep other males off of that territory?
That's right. Yeah. So other males, so they don't have overlapping male home ranges. The female that 600 square miles will generally overlap two or three female home ranges. And those female home ranges generally don't overlap themselves.
Right.
Yeah, that's a great question. And so would the male breed with all three of those females or just one of them? And it's a good question that we don't really know an answer to. I think generally they will, but it's unknown. The denning ecology and the reproductive ecology is very poorly known in the lower 48. Throughout the range, it's poorly known, I should say. Sloan.
So if the decision is made to go forward with reintroduction, I'm sure folks here are interested in what they can do to help.
Yeah.
Short of grabbing a pickup truck load of them.
I appreciate the caution. Yeah.
But, I mean, ultimately, you pointed out there's a political component to this decision-making process, and I presume that there will be a point in time in which it would be really good if those of us interested in seeing Wolverine on the ground in Colorado weighed in and participated in that. But maybe now's not the time, and when might that time be?
Yeah, so the question is, how do you engage? How does the citizen engage in this process? Because it is a politically sensitive process and all that. And really, so you know, right now there's this open comment period to the Fish and Wildlife Service for their proposed rules. They'd love to hear any information that people have, not so much on the advocacy of, yes, we want this, we're in favor of this. If you have information to contribute from a scientific perspective, providing an advocacy type of position is of interest. But you know, when it comes time to going to the commission or going to our legislature, they may be interested in hearing from you know, constituents at that time too. So it is that process of engaging with the decision makers and letting them know what your interests are. Thanks. Yeah, so keep the pickup trucks in your driveways. Great. Thank you all for coming.
Good job, man.
Thanks, man.
It's really good.
Thanks.
Professionally done.
Oh.
Yeah.